Bonjour,
thank you to everyone for joining us here today.
Alors, je vais parler en français d'abord, mais sachez qu'après, cette conférence sera en anglais, interprétée en simultané en français. Donc, tout d'abord, je voulais expliquer aux personnes qui se connectent comment faire ça. Donc, sur Zoom, vous devriez avoir dans la barre de menu du bas l'option interprétation que vous pouvez ouvrir et sélectionner la langue française. Et comme ça, vous entendrez au cours de la conférence les interventions en anglais traduites en simultané en français par nos interprètes Colin et Christopher. Si vous avez un souci, vous pouvez mettre un message dans le chat et mes collègues pourront essayer de vous aider avec ça. So now I'm going to switch to English for the rest of this talk. So thank you very much to Marku and Douglas and John for joining us today. As I guess I explained briefly when we were chatting just now, this is the third roundtable of the day. So today is a day on which we're gathering a variety of specialists, activists, musicians who are involved overall in the question of inclusion within the context of musical practice and specifically music education. And it coincides with the release of a book which Brutpop, our association, has been writing over the past year and a half, in which we've interviewed many of the people who we've spoken to throughout the day, as well as other people who weren't able to join us today. The book, which I think you can see here, is called Enseignement musical et handicap 15 questions. So that's musical education and disability, 15 questions. And we're very thankful for all of you to have participated, to have given us so much time to discuss the projects you have, your ideas, your philosophy, and that has really affected our thinking in this, and we hope that it can really contribute to the conversation in France. And that's really the topic of today's roundtable. This morning we were speaking to a variety of specialists, of music school directors, of teachers around France who work on this question. But as you know, throughout the research process for this roundtable, we went to speak to people in Finland, so including Marku, as well as in the United Kingdom, so our colleagues at Drake Music, John and Douglas, who are here with us today. And that has really enormously illuminated our, the conversations we've had have brought a lot of new perspectives, a lot of interesting approaches, and we're really thankful for that. And the goal today is to kind of share these with our French audience, with the hope that it'll nourish the discussion. And actually on that note, I should recall one of the things that we've learned from Drake Music in terms of accessibility and inclusion is it's something that applies at all times throughout any phase really of the work we're doing. And an example of that is a proposition that they do every time that they do webinars or any type of conference online, which is audio description. So I will audio describe myself. I am a white passing Latino male, about 30 years old, wearing glasses with long hair tied back. And I'm sitting at a table with a laptop and I was holding up an orange, pretty bright orange book with an illustration on the cover of lots of different people playing music. And I'm sitting in a large space, a warehouse a venue called La Station Gare des Mines in the north of Paris. So I really look forward to getting into the different details of the different projects and models that Douglas, John, and Marku carry out in the United Kingdom and Finland, respectively. So I'd like to ask, just to start, to have each of you kind of present yourself briefly and a bit of your journey. So we'll maybe start with Marku. Perhaps you could tell us a bit about who you are, where you're coming from, about Resonari, the music school which you co-founded and are now director of. And then, of course, we'll get into a lot of details about that after, but we'll start with hearing a bit about you.
Yes, thank you. Good afternoon and greetings from Helsinki, Finland, and greetings from Music Center Resonari. My name is Markku Kaikkonen, and a music educator, music teacher, and now also director of Resonari. I always say the heart of our music center is our music school. And in Resonari Music School, we have close to 300 pupils, 300 musicians, who are coming once or twice a week for a lesson, individual or group lesson. Actually, we have around 30 bands, so we have a lot of band playing in in our music school. So basically, Resonari Music School, it is the similar than any other music school in Finland. But actually our doors are open for all learners. So if anyone has difficulties studying in so-called ordinary methods, is welcome to study in Resonari. Resonari is founded in 1995, and in the beginning we have a lot of musicians, people with intellectual and developmental disabilities, but nowadays we can say we have so many backgrounds, if thinking the musicians who are coming to study and learn music in Resonari. New growing target group is senior citizens, so it's really interesting also. So the learning goals and capabilities of the students are different. Each student or each musician is taught based on a goal-oriented individual teaching plan. So basically in the same way like in all other music schools. And it means Resonari also follows Finnish national curriculum for music schools, for art education. And in that way, we also have official music school status. So in that way, Resonari is also one of the pioneers who have started to talk about equality in learning music and in Finland. And in that way, it has been really interesting for us. Because of that, we have started to have a lot of collaboration with different partners in development work and in research. And for example, we are partner of a research project called Arts EQL, coordinated by University of the Arts in Helsinki. But now I'm happy to be here, and I think this is the basic things about Resonari.
Great, thank you very much, Markku. Maybe so we can move on to John Kelly. If you want to maybe briefly kind of just present yourself, and then Douglas, you could also both give us a little presentation about who you are, and then we'll move on to talking about your work with Drake Music.
Cool, great. Thank you so much. It's just really, really lovely to be here in this strange Zoom world that we have now, but it's absolutely beautiful to be here. I'm John Kelly. I'm a professional musician, and I'm also a qualified facilitator and coach. I've worked in both music and music education for the last just under 35 years. I'm a practitioner, so I work and perform and I tour all over the world. I use music technology as part of my performance, but essentially I'm a vocalist, a singer. And in education, I've worked in the last 30 years, both in informal education and formal education, working with disabled and non-disabled people on equal terms. So working in environments where we've developed our understanding of inclusion and our understanding of practice our understanding of inclusion. So I'm currently working on my new album, which will be out at the end of the year. And I've got a piece of music technology, which is a bespoke guitar that I use as part of my performance. And my songwriting is about my experience as an Irish man living in England and also as a disabled person who experiences all sorts of barriers and assumptions and prejudices that need to be smashed and broken. I'm also an associate artist, a national associate artist with Drake Music, and I work freelance, so I work with a number of organisations. But my motivation is always to work with grassroots organisations, so organisations that work together with disabled and non-disabled people in the lead. So it's really, really important to me that Drake as an organisation works on equal terms with disabled and non-disabled people throughout the organisation. So right from the board of trustees, right through the staffing structure, it's about us all working together rather than non-disabled people working for disabled people, whatever. And I'm really pleased to be here with my colleague Douglas, who I'll hand over to introduce himself. I should say I'm a white male. I've got brown hair with a little kiss curl drop down onto my forehead. I've got a nice little microphone popping into my screen, and in the background I've got lots of musically related pictures and wall hangings, including peace, love and rock and roll, which is what the world needs right now. So over to you, Douglas.
Thanks, John. And yeah, absolutely delighted to be invited to be part of this conference today by Britpop, our friends at Britpop in Paris. My name's Douglas Noble. I'm speaking to you from my house in Devon in the southwest of England. I'm a white male in my early 50s. I'm wearing a green shirt with an open neck. I wear glasses which have black square rims. I'm wearing Numark headphones. Other brands are available. And behind me, you can see a tempting slice of my vinyl collection in shelves, racks. That's a very small proportion of it, with a disco ball on top, which might tell you a little bit about some of the music that I play. So I work for Drake Music as the program lead on a program called Think 22, which John and I will tell you a little bit about in a little while, and which is working with music education hubs, and I'll tell you what I mean by that as well. I'm a consultant, an arts consultant, particularly working in the area of inclusion in music ed with disabled people and with disabled people, as John talked about, and we'll talk a little bit more about that in a bit, through Drake Music. I also work for an organisation called Live Music Now, which is work which is focused on music with older people, particularly people living with dementia, where I have a national strategic role around that, working with older people living in care settings, in residential care settings. And I'm also a DJ, music producer and radio host. So that's me. So perhaps we could, if that's okay, Alejandro, we could go on and just talk a little bit about our program of work with Music Education Hubs and Drake Music. So in order to do that, is that okay now, or?
That's great. I just wanted to contextualize a tiny bit.
Because yes, of course, go ahead.
Yes, because this morning, actually, our first panel discussion, we were talking with, we were kind of trying to address this idea of the complexity of inclusion and what are the challenges that are faced, what are the difficulties, what are the hurdles to overcome. And we had someone who was a representative of a local government of the sort of suburb northwest of Paris in which we are currently. And she was kind of pinpointing the fact that there's this difficulty to coordinate across different local governments, across music schools, across different types of basically all the people who are affected, who are concerned by these questions. And that's why I think we're quite curious about these music education hubs that there are in the UK, which sort of seem to draw together lots of different players in order to create a sort of pedagogical proposition which can be quite interesting and unique with different levels of coordination. And I also am really interested, and I think you'll talk about it, in what John was alluding to, the fact that at Drake Music you really work together with disabled and non-disabled people, collaborating, supporting each other, working together towards a common goal. And I think that's also something that we find relatively lacking in France to an extent. So these are two aspects which I think you'll be telling us about, and we're excited to hear about.
Thank you. Merci, I should say. And so I will bring some slides up now, if that's okay. And John and I will try and go through these without it being, you know, too drawn out, so that there's obviously there's space for people to kind of delve into the issues that we raise, and obviously what Mark has been bringing in terms of his expertise and practice as well. So hopefully those are visible. And I'm actually going to hand over to John to do the intro bit, if that's okay.
Great. Thank you, Douglas. So the first slide shows some little programmable computers called Arduinos, which is kind of, I guess, where Drake Music is known for being leaders in music, disability and technology. And there's a slide with our names on, Douglas and John, and we're lovely. It's great to be here. I guess I really want to say right from the onset that our belief is that inclusion is a bold and radical change in practice. So as a result of that, Drake Music are innovators, educators, curators and advocates for change and music. We believe that everyone has the right to express themselves creatively through music. We use new technologies and ideas to open up access to music for all. Our vision is a world where disabled and non-disabled musicians work together as equals. So, Drake Music broadly falls into sort of four strands of work. We've been on a massive journey of change in terms of the organisation being much more reflective of the diverse workforce. But essentially, it falls into these four categories of learning and participation, which is delivery and real participatory work, making music with young people. Primarily, but also with people of all ages. Training and consultancy is really about looking outside of our organisation and sharing our learning with others. But critically also, it's also about internally us looking at ourselves as an organisation and what our learning is. Research and development is really about finding new solutions and being curious about possibility and really creating new instruments, bespoke instruments, music technology, and pushing things to the limits, breaking barriers. And finally, arts and collaboration is really where it's an area of our work where we commission and we highlight good practice around the arts and in essentially put on events and music made and created that is to a very high quality for audiences to enjoy, to just sort of demonstrate really that what we're really talking about is really, really good music, exciting, creative, engaging, thought-provoking, challenging music that enriches all our lives. So that's a little bit about some of Drake's work. I mentioned that we, as part of that, have been on a journey as an organisation. And so one strand of our training and consultancy is the work we're doing in Music Hubs and Think 22. So I'll hand over to Douglas to take that focus of our work on further with you now.
So, yeah, thanks, John. So Think 22 is a national program working with music education hubs. And just to give brief bit of explanation of what I mean by music education hubs. It's a network of organisations across England, so not the whole of the United Kingdom, across England. They're government funded through the Arts Council, which is a strand of government funding through the Department for Culture, Media and Sport, DCMS. And each region or area has its own music education hub. There's about 120, and they are responsible for the music education needs, access, opportunities, participation. They've got sort of core roles that are dictated by the government in a national music education plan, which is very out of date and old now, and is very overdue for being revised. And so the idea is that they're kind of groups. The idea of the hub is that they're groups of organisation that meet all the music education activity, participation, etc. needs of the young people in their areas. So our work with them is through this programme called Think 22, which is funded by Youth Music as part of their programme called the Alliance for a Musically Inclusive England. And there's 14 organisations who are funded to work strategically and at a national level with those music education hubs. And we partner with four hubs very closely, but work with many others throughout this programme. So that's just a bit about Think 22. And then I'm going to talk a little bit more about what that is. So there's three strands. So that's delivery, which is making music with people, supporting young people. As I said, it's aimed at children and young people. That's aged 5 to 25. It's workforce development. So that's training the music education workforce. And it's advocacy. So that's campaigning for change, essentially. And we'll talk about some of the ideas that inform that. John will talk a little bit more about the rights-based ideas. That also Marco was talking about rights-based ideas. There's obviously some real crossover there. Our aims are really working on this idea of inclusion as a holistic thing. That's to say, from the delivery, so what music is made with and done alongside children and young people, also right back through to the heart of the organisation. So how inclusive is the organisation and how can we support that inclusion journey? Of course, the aim is about good music education for all. And what we mean by that is that the whole offer is accessible and available to all, the whole offer of the hubs. That's to say that any person with any particular barriers they might have, disabling barriers to being a musician, children and young people, can access the whole of the offer of that hub. Of course, that is a journey, and you know, the key message that we keep working around is that this is, you know, that's not a destination and that's not going to happen overnight, so we have to work towards that, including Drake. We're on that journey as well, and every step forward is progress. And also that that's a positive journey, so it brings lots of opportunities. So it's not just about the challenges and the difficulties of working with disabled musicians, it's also about the opportunities and excitements that brings, and the benefits for the whole organisation and everyone who works within it. And that is everybody's responsibility. So when you take on that journey, you start that journey, you take on a responsibility for keeping on that journey and for everybody being part of that. It seems like my slides have gone away. I'm just going to see if I can share those again. Don't know why that was. Okay. Just going to move on. We've asked ourselves what we mean by inclusion, and there's a quote here from Roger Slee, which talks about the idea that theories of inclusive education commence with technical considerations of the means for achieving inclusion, but that reduces inclusive education to a list of policies, strategies and resources. These activities to pursue inclusive education represent a necessary and important discussion, but it must be a second order discussion. The first requirement is to establish our goals and aspirations. Inclusive education commences with the recognition of the unequal social relations that produce exclusion. From that point, we can pursue a less capricious process of developing our strategic discussion. In a sense, we felt that a really important part of our journey with the hubs is to try and define what we mean by inclusion. So that quote from Roger Slee is talking about how inclusion is about attitudinal and cultural and principle change, as well as practice and activity and strategy change. So as part of our Think 22 journey, we published a document called What is Inclusion? Making Music is the Key, which was authored by John Kelly. And we identified four principles of inclusion. So the first one being belonging, i.e. belonging in the music education hubs offer. Do disabled people feel they have their needs reflected as being understood? Do they feel welcome and comfortable? Understanding, that's understanding of issues that are barriers to inclusion, such as disability, race, gender, that work in both directions, i.e. how do we understand each other as human beings, speak and engage with each other. Participation and contribution, how do music education hubs include and work with disabled people, and through that the sector learns how to include. And being valued, recognition, celebration, accreditation, so the value of what people achieve being recognised, celebrated and accredited. And I'm just going to hand back to John to talk a little bit about the rights context.
So I think in Slee's quote, he really nicely articulates that the inclusion is about addressing inequality, and the social model of disability is part of that discussion, part of that journey, which is about, as an organisation, when we think about inclusion, then we need a rethink about what we mean by disability. And the dominant model of disability in our society, in our world, is the idea that disability is about my condition, my body. My body is the problem. But the social model is a radical definition of disability that has been created by disabled people. We have realised that our experience is about a lack of opportunities, not being able to reach our potential. It's got nothing to do with our bodies or our ability, but it's about political structures, systems, the way in which we're being asked to fit into a world that hasn't been part of our creation. So the social model of disability is a radical way of defining disability, which says that disability isn't about our bodies, but it's about the barriers that society creates. And that's where our focus needs to be. If we change and understand that what we really want to talk about is accessibility and participation and being there as ourselves, authentically being valued as people who bring all sorts of differences, and that enriches. So the social model challenges the dominant model that society has, and it says that essentially disability is a rights struggle. It's about a struggle to end our discrimination and oppression as disabled people. And that starts with our education system. It starts with how we understand inclusion. So that kind of informs those four principles that Douglas shared in terms of understanding what we mean by disability. And it's really, really critical that understanding is grassroots led. So the social model of disability has informed our activism as disabled people in the UK disability movement, and globally. Actually, it's a globally shared idea. It's not no longer a UK idea that disability is a social construct. We share that globally with other disabled colleagues all over the world who are also fighting discrimination and oppression. So over to Douglas to talk a little bit more about inclusive practice.
Thanks, John. Thank you. I'm just going to say give one more example before I'll go back to Alejandro, because I know you've got questions and want to bring Marco in as well, of course. But I just wanted to give an example of how we're bringing the social model into our work with hubs, because the evidence was telling us that if we brought the social model into our workforce development as an attitudinal, a cultural, a principle, a sort of thinking-based intervention with music education organisations and practitioners, the practice-based training that we also offered around the use of music tech and overcoming disabling barriers to young people being musicians, if we brought the social model in alongside that, it, increased the impact of the practice-based training. So we've designed a course that joins the two together, or it's a day's training, I should say, and it's called Inclusion and Music Tech in Practice, and it's designed and delivered by trainers with lived experience of disability and expert music education participation and practice. And we bring those two things together, and by unpacking the social model and then putting it in the context of practice, we're finding the impact around the confidence, understanding and practice, which are the measures, the outcome measures that we follow with our work with Hubs, is much more impactful. So we brought that social model into the way that that we work directly with those Hubs. There are other examples, which I'm sure we'll bring in, but I'm going to sort of hand back to Alejandro, because I know we need to make sure there's time for questions.
Yeah, thank you so much, John and Douglas. It's I mean, it's always really inspiring to hear about the work you do with Drake. And there are really so many aspects that we could dig into. And I think there are really interesting parallels with Finland. Marco, I'm sure you probably have a lot of aspects you could touch upon, but maybe one that I think spoke to me the most in what John and Douglas just presented is this idea of moving away from inclusion as something that's reduced to a set of policies or strategies and resources, and rather to think about what are our aspirations, what do we think of as inclusion, what do we want inclusion to be. And I was wondering how, if this is a sort of thinking that has been kind of part of your career, your development, and how that plays with an institution like Resonare, which, if I'm not mistaken, has been around for 20 to 30 years and is quite established and has a sort of an important presence nationally and even internationally. Do you feel like you managed to still have this forward-looking, sort of reflexive, philosophical approach rather than kind of be reduced to being asked to have sort of very specific strategies that then, once they're set, they can't really move and evolve in the vision of inclusion as a process, as John and Douglas alluded to?
Yes, thank you. Many questions and big questions you have at the same time. So, I'm a music teacher, so maybe a lot of my thinking is coming from the practice. And now the main goal or dream for me is the democracy in learning. And for me, personally, for me, the starting point is to trust the potential of everyone who is coming to me. So if somebody is coming, open the door and coming to me, so my task as a teacher is to find the way how to make music possible for this person. And it means as a teacher, I need a lot of different pedagogical tools, approaches, and knowledge about this area. And I just need to trust the potential, and I need to respect everyone as a musician, even in the beginning of the musical studies. And in that way, a learning process is starting, and musicality is growing. And maybe for some, learning takes a little bit longer than for the others, but we are not in a hurry. My task as a teacher is to enjoy what we have learned, and then I give new challenges. And now very soon 30 years, what we have worked in Resonare. So many of our musicians, so it has this learning has taken long time, but it has been fantastic to see what has happened to these musicians. Some are happy with the studies, some are making music still, but then there are also professional musicians who are now part of the society in different institutes, or like our ex-musicians, a couple of years ago, they were presenting Finland in European Song Contest. And so there are a lot of possibilities if we just open those doors. And as the music teacher, once again, the most important thing is to find these basic things, how to trust the potential in everyone, even if somebody maybe looks a little bit different or something like that. But I'm happy if thinking the change, what has happened in Finland. So when we started in Resonare, maybe all this, it was a little bit new, and maybe it was the question about the attitudes. Somebody just thought learning is not possible for all. But now, if thinking after all these years, it's like normal thing. So of course, music schools should open the doors. And now the questions in music schools, for example, are what kind of pedagogical tools we could have, how to start working. And I'm happy now if thinking, for example, universities in Finland, they have started to have also studies where they try to find and introduce this kind of special educational models or approaches or different ways for teaching in many-sided ways. And then I'm happy if thinking our politicians, or for example, National Board of Education, who is giving national curriculums for music schools. So if thinking curriculums for music schools nowadays, it is written, it's possible to make these kind of individual individual curriculums for each pupil. Traditionally, music school have been very, it has been a little bit with different tests, and the target has been only professional career in the orchestra or something, somewhere else. But now this attitude and starting point, it has changed a lot. But of course, if thinking still I'm thinking we are in the beginning of this positive change, but step by step, more and more this kind of opportunities have started to be open. And I'm really happy we are in Resonare, we make a lot of collaboration, for example, with National Board of Education, and we are giving courses to different music schools and teacher training. And it has been fantastic to see how teachers in Finland, they have a big interest to find new ways, and they have a big interest to find a little bit more wide thinking. And it's really a positive what has happened in Finland. And after all this 20 or even more close to 30 years, it is it sometimes it I feel it's a long time, but still it's a really short time if thinking what all has happened. So, one more thing I want to repeat what I told. The most important thing for us as the teacher is to find a way how to make music possible for all. And if we have a success in this, so it's a key for the change for this person, for the people around this person who is our musician, and also it is the key for the change in whole society, and whole society starts to be more equal, inclusive, and more human.
Yeah, thank you so much, Marku. I'm really interested, it's really excited to hear about everything that you've been doing with Resonare. And in particular, I find it really encouraging that you're saying that now that you're doing these trainings for teachers throughout Finland, that they're very receptive to it and really interested in kind of moving forward on this. And that's kind of related, it's interesting because this morning when we were talking about the case in France, we were actually pinpointing the fact that for a lot of teachers in, especially in the conservatory system, which I think even outside of France, it probably has this reputation of being relatively rigid, kind of has existed for hundreds of years, quite strict. And with the question of inclusion, a lot of teachers might be a bit reluctant, a bit scared, even a bit uncertain. They don't really know like how it will change their profession. So it sounds like in Finland there's a lot of progress on this level. And I guess a question I wanted to ask this to John or to Douglas about how they see it in the UK, because John, you talked about how inclusion, I think you used the terms maybe subversive or even radical, and how inclusion can really is really something that is meant to sort of challenge a status quo if we want to think seriously about inclusion. So I was wondering, in your experience over the past years, whether with Drake or in other projects, kind of what are the big challenges that you're up against in terms of mentalities, in terms of sort of a status quo that's hard to shift? And maybe do you have any specific successes you could pinpoint? Do you have a general sense of optimism about how things are moving forward? Or are there things that you sort of set and you're not really sure how to get them to change?
Yeah, always optimistic and very, very excited. Always. There's always opportunities. I think what Marku highlighted so beautifully was that there are two things really. One is I think teachers are such amazing people because they always start with that question, what do I need to do to make this happen? So there's a real openness to really, really thinking about the person-centered approach to learning, making sure that the child is central to kind of what goes on. And it's only when our policies and all those things kind of get in the way of, like, how do you measure it and all those kinds of things, that we start to get sort of challenged in our approaches. But I think it's really, really important to that we start by exciting teachers, that we encourage teachers, that actually this isn't something to be scared of. This is something that enriches, that brings what I believe is good teaching. A good teacher is someone who asks questions, who's curious, who is excited, who motivates. So that's what I see when I work in schools with teachers. I see people working really hard at trying to make the class and make music work with the students. I think the other thing that Marku talked about, which is really, really important, is that there's not one approach. There's not one single answer to this. The key to democracy for me is about power shifting. It's about changing inequality. And teachers, you know, the teachers that excite me are those that don't see themselves as having all the answers. The teachers who are going to, you know, pour in all this knowledge and information to a student, that's not our role. Our role is to help people to flourish and reach their potential and to sort of demonstrate that progression. And that's what I believe in. So I think Marku again beautifully said that kind of idea of like helping the student. And I'm fortunate. I work with some brilliant teachers, both formally and informally, because I think there's different ways in to learning. And I think equally we need to value informal routes in to demonstrating the same outcome. And we need to challenge some of the elitism that is around education and some of the elitism that's around music, so that we start to really consider what equality is and what the kind of society we want to live in.
Can I just add thanks, John. Can I add a little bit to that in terms of an example, Alejandro? Yeah. You know, going back to what we were talking about, our workforce development process with Hubs. I mean, there's an enormous amount of enthusiasm and interest for working inclusively and involving everybody, allowing access of everybody to the music education offer. And that comes from both at a sector level, a policy level, and also, of course, individual music educators. So right the way across, there's all that interest. So don't get us wrong, there's massive interest in it in the UK and in England, and a lot of work going into it. But what we're saying is, we really want to say, okay, so music educators are very experienced people, got lots of knowledge and experience. They're doing it through their dedication and their passion, and have been practicing for many years. Where there are maybe barriers to them, to people feeling that they have the confidence or skills to work with disabled musicians as learners. We say, well, how can we unlock that, all that amazing knowledge, experience, willingness, enthusiasm, so that it overcomes those barriers? So that social model training is the kind of entry point for that. And then taking that into a practice-based framework. So how do we apply that alongside the social model? So that being very practical around accessible music practice. And out of that, we've identified what we are calling the core competencies of inclusive practice. So 10 points, I won't go all the way through, and we'll share them through Alejandro, and we'll share a whole load of links that people can look at. But looking at the individual music educators that we're working with and working with them on a one-to-one basis, say, are you able to meet these core competencies as the building blocks of your inclusive practice? And then through training, webinars, one-to-one mentoring, observation, working very closely with them, nurturing the growth of those core competencies and using the evidence that comes out of that to inform how, where the gaps are, and then targeting our training into those gaps and saying, well, okay, so we work with a body of music educators. So where we're seeing the gaps in that body, we extrapolate that up to the wider music education workforce. So then when we offer training out to the wider workforce, we again, we're targeting to those gaps. So for example, we run a series of webinars, and there's one next Thursday on the use of music tech for next Thursday afternoon. And I'll share the link to that because people can sign up to that. There's a small charge, but people can sign up.
May I just chuck something very quickly in, which is the notion also about who the teacher is, and one of the critical things around inclusion for us is that idea that we see what we can be. And so there's a really, really important thing about our collaboration as disabled and non-disabled people. So we need to see disabled people as teachers as well. And that kind of representation in the workforce. It's not about pushing one person out. It's not about one answer, but it's about it's about us seeing who we can be. And therefore, disabled people need opportunities in the music education sector to become teachers, so that, you know, as a child, I see someone who I would want to be like. And someone who maybe comes from my perspective, who understands the barriers that I might experience. So, and we believe that's about inclusion. That's about us collaborating and working together as equals.
Yeah, thanks so much, John and Douglas, for that. I wanted to, we'll open up for questions in a second. So if anyone in the chat wants to ask a question, we have about 10 minutes left, or in the audience here, you can also ask it in French and I can translate it. But I just wanted to maybe ask Douglas, you talked about these 10 core competencies. Maybe you could specify a couple of them, because it's this question of sort of training and sort of what type of training you need to be able to kind of work inclusively, if we could put it that way. It's kind of been central to our work, and our conclusion was sort of that training is sort of a bit of a myth, and that it's really kind of through experience and through, I think, embracing the values that both, that all three of you have presented, you know, believing in the ability of everyone to create music, trusting people in terms of the potential of learning, et cetera. But I was kind of curious to know, in these 10 competencies to develop, are there one or two of them in particular that you could share with us?
Absolutely. In fact, I've just shared a slide there. I don't know if people can see it. I'll put it up as a, so it's full screen, which is lists them all. There it is. I won't go through all of them, and I'll share these. So a couple of examples: being able to describe the social model of disability, which, as we say, with that being our entry point. Then there's one around that, something called Sounds of Intent, which is a progress framework, a person-centered progress framework developed by Professor Adam Ockleford from the University of Roehampton. So that's a way of measuring progress of individual musicians against very person-centered, holistic, rather than kind of benchmark type ways of measuring progress. And then there's another one there about Makaton, which is about using non-spoken means of communication. Like a sign, a simple form of sign language that's very universally used. There's stuff in there about use of music tech and then into some specifics about particular iPads. So that sort of gives you a kind of a taste of them. And then we, as I say, we have our individual learners, music tutors that we're working with. We kind of they have reflective framework which they use to measure their progress against those, and a one-to-one mentoring process with some of our practitioners, our lead associates, trainers, some amazing colleagues of mine, who I have to big up for the enormous amount of work they've put into putting those together over the last few years. And we're not saying that's the whole of it. That's not like you've got that and that's the whole world. You've done it. That's the basic building blocks.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. No, that's great. Thanks. It's really interesting to see it's what you share there. And I think that having the social model at the top is really powerful and definitely something that we could incorporate here. I don't see any questions in the chat. I don't know if anyone in the audience has a question. Si quelqu'un a une question? Okay, if not, I have another question for Marku. Well, if we have time, maybe we can have different perspectives on this. But I was kind of interested in this idea of Resonari as sort of this key institution in Finland that's existed for 25 to 30 years. And at the same time, through a lot of our discussion, we've kind of talked about this responsibility at an individual level as a teacher to kind of trust the student, to be able to adapt, to be open to working with different types of people, with different approaches. So I was wondering how how Resonari manages to disseminate this approach throughout the country. Maybe you could tell us specifically, because I know that there are quite close links at the political level or even at the level of sort of the university academic research level with Sibelius Academy. Could you tell us a little bit about how this sort of unique maybe triangle with Resonari works in Finland?
Yes, okay. First of all, I think we have been really lucky. So, we have also made a lot of work to find good people around us. So collaboration with different institutions has been the key word. So from the very beginning, we have been in contact to politicians and politicians and associations, universities, music schools, teachers, and and we have wanted to be a part of the society from the very beginning. So when we started, very quickly we came out from our music school and started to make a collaboration also with different artists, and our musicians started to perform together with other Finnish artists or musicians. So we wanted to show it's possible, this learning is also possible. And I think this kind of collaboration and somehow openness to the society has been really important, because in that way all other people, they have needed to analyze or think, what does it mean? What is happening in the society? Like nowadays, my ex pupils, they are also teacher trainers together with me. We are giving music educational courses, and some of our musicians are performing together with Finnish musicians, and it has been like a good vibration in pedagogical field of Finnish society, but also in cultural level in society, somehow it is really important to give a flag up, and then it's important to tell what we are doing, and in that way also attitudes are changing, finally in that way I believe I believe the interest has grown a lot in Finland.
That's wonderful, and I think kind of resonates what you said at the beginning about how from the beginning you had this
this kind of goal, this desire to be part of, to connect with society, with artists, with at a political level, academically, et cetera. And it resonates with a lot of things we've heard throughout the past hour. I think, John, you talked about democracy, we've talked about activism, we talked about music education, also in the context of education in general, in the context of sort of democratic inclusion, which leaves a really great transition because that's kind of the topic of the last panel, where we'll be discussing with André Fertier and Tubiki Laes, really about trying to dig into what is inclusion, what can inclusion be, what do we want to imagine it as. So really excited for that, which will be in about 15 minutes. I don't know if John or Douglas, you have anything to add to react to what Marco just said, or else we can leave it there.
I'll just very briefly on the policy level, I referred to the National Plan for Music Education, which is what brought Hubs about, that is under revision at the moment. So that's a government piece of guidance for how the Hubs frame their offer. And just to say, it's sort of 7 years old now, I think, something like that, or maybe even 8 years old. But anyway, there is an intention for it to be revised, and ourselves and many other organisations have been part of the process around what we hope informing how that will evolve into something where inclusion, in the same way that we've been talking about in this session, is a holistic element of it that runs right the way through everything within it, as opposed to, you know, an additional siloed aspect that sits on the end. So there's something there about the kind of inclusion being at the heart of music ed as well at the government level. We hope, we're waiting to see that published yet, but there are good signs that that will happen. But also just to say thank you for inviting us. It's been really lovely to be part of this panel, and to, you know, to share with Marco and with our friends at Brewpop, and the audience.
Thank you to the three of you, to Marco, John and Douglas, for joining us. We really appreciate it, and thank you to the audience who is here still with us at La Station, the people who are with us online, and everyone who will watch this once we put it online in a few weeks. So we're going to break now, and then we'll be back in 15 minutes for the final panel, which is Penser l'inclusion, Thinking Inclusion, with Tulik Elias and André Fertier.